Welcome, everybody. Thanks for coming. I know some of you are regulars and some of you are just joining us maybe for the first time. Some first timers. Welcome to Occupy Natick. This is our monthly What Went Wrong movie and panel discussion series that we started about 3 years ago. And it's been very, I would say, very successful. A lot of interesting content that we put out there. Back in the fall, we had a panel discussion that I think was more focused on local efforts around the environment. And Tara was one of the presenters, but we found what she had to say so interesting and realized that we really didn't have enough time to cover the breadth of her knowledge and skills in just 20 minutes that have been allotted to her, that we invited her to come back and present for her own hour and a half. So we are very thankful that she's so graciously been willing to volunteer her time. She does a lot of volunteering. I told Tara that I went out and sort of cobbled together some different descriptors so I could introduce her, but one of the things I liked is I think she wrote about herself. She's a community activist, volunteer coordinator, project manager, independent business owner, traveler, artist, partner, sister, daughter, and neighbor. So I think that's pretty comprehensive. But I think, you know, one of the things that I like the most about Tara when I see her present and when I see her in action is that she's a very positive person, and I think her message is one that's very positive, and I think, you know, we have a tendency in all the films and discussions that we have, it can get very demoralizing after democracy is broken, the system stinks, you know, blah, blah, blah. But I think that Tara brings a really positive approach to that and in trying to teach us that we really have more power and ability to address those things than we think we do. And I think she brings a lot of excitement and enthusiasm to sharing that knowledge with people. And I think, as a town meeting member, I can say that democracy is really granular and it really does work in a lot of ways at the local level. I think the further you get from the local level is where more of the corruption sets in. But the more engaged we are locally, the more power we really do have. And so I think it's really important to, you know, and again, that we're really lucky to have Tara here to help us figure it all out. So a few announcements before we get going. So only the men's room is working this evening. As you can see, the space is under a little bit of construction. So for our purposes tonight, we have repurposed it to a unisex bathroom, and it's out in the main hall to the right. Late breaking news on May 7th, I'm going to make an announcement on behalf of our Wellesley neighbors that Joanna Macy is going to be doing a presentation on global warming and active hope at Wellesley College at the Jewett Arts Center, May 7th at 7 p.m. Our next film is going to be May 18th without some controversy. I will just throw that in there. It is Cowspiracies, or some version therein. And on the table in the back, we do have a sign-in sheet if you want to get emails from us. I send a couple a month just to let you know what we're up to. There is a donation jar. We do give some proceeds to the church for letting us kindly use their space. I've put two books out there. One is Doing Democracy, and of course now I'm blanking on the other one. They're really interesting books. They are not for you to take, but you may peruse them, and if it's something you decide you'd like to have, then you have the titles there. So I think that's it. Off to Tara Friedrich.
Thank you so much. And thank you for being here and for carrying on the Occupy thing. Because I think this is what Beth and I were talking about. I think this is the only operating General Assembly group in the state that I know of. Yes, and so others, there are some that happen sometimes, so like Occupy Arlington, Occupy Winchester, but this one happens regularly, and so people know they can be here and they can know that it'll happen, and I think that's really exciting. And so, and thank you for a wonderful introduction, I really appreciate that. I would like very much to recognize today being Patriots Day, just take a moment of silence for the genocide that has taken place and continues to take place in Native American communities by systematic oppression, the stealing of land rights and water rights for fracking and pipelines and various other, you know, long list of abuses on the Native American community. And so I would just like to take just a moment, 30 seconds or so, and just bow our heads in silence for the oppression that continues from that. Thank you very much. Mike, you had an announcement? If anybody else has an announcement, please feel free to.
Thank you, Tara. I just wanted to mention, for those of you who are interested in global warming and do something about it, Senator Mike Barrett's going to be speaking in Westboro tomorrow night from 7 to, well, he won't be speaking from 7 to 9. We're going to have a Democratic Town Committee meeting at Tatnut Bookstore starting at 7, at which Mike Barrett will be talking about how to stop global warming by passing his particular bill that's coming up for voting on, well.
The carbon fee? Carbon fee?
Carbon fee, yes, thank you. Which probably will get passed in 2016, but we're starting to push for it right now. So please come to Westboro.
And the name of the bill is carbon feed?
Fee.
Fee, okay.
So it's paying for what you use?
Yep.
As opposed to carbon tax, which sounds like it's, you know, just taxation. It's really to pay for what you're using. And then pass mass amendment, if anybody is interested in helping fix democracy, pass mass amendment is to use the state constitution, amend the state constitution, say corporations are not people, money is not speech. It's an ongoing petitioning effort that's going to start up in the fall, but the legislators have seen fit to put two bills forth in the House and the Senate.
Mm-hmm.
So there's hearings coming up. We think it's going to be on the 27th or 28th. They haven't announced it yet, but feel free to come and testify. Janet was there. Day was there last week testifying, so we can use letters of support, so we actually hand those letters into the committee for many organizations in particular, if any organization can write a paragraph or two, as well as put your name on a list of people that support. It's at passmassamendment.org. We have flyers and stuff like that. Janet can probably handle that. Well, I got the list here if you want.
La la la.
This is passmassamendment.
So we're to pass this around for people to sign.
Yeah, yeah.
But if we've already signed.
If you're already on a master list, then come on. Yeah, this is just to get on the master list.
You want to be on the master list.
All right,
report
to Ash Closely Lens.
Oh, updates and stuff. It's only like once a month.
If you want to be notified about the hearing, pass mass amendment at gmail.com. Gmail's not an org yet, but perhaps in the future someday. But now, yes, and so the point of my presentation today is to talk about how much power we have at the local level. And the reason that I started to cage this in this manner was because I was so frustrated. I was an elected official in Acton, and before that I was appointed official, and as I was engaging with local government, people kept telling me how much I couldn't do. Okay, you can't save that old barn. You can't save those trees. You can't this, you can't that. Why? Well, because of the economy or because of the growth that's needed for housing. And so I said, well, wait a second, but this housing is being made for people who don't need help. These are $600,000 townhouses. So why are we losing this forest because of, you know, these people who don't even need any help? They just want to get into a good school system or move to Massachusetts. But then I started looking at that, and people are saying, well, yeah, we do need housing. No, 15 to 20% of housing is actually vacant at any moment in time. So it's all a market play on you guys, because they make you think that you need housing, when really what you need is you need really, truly affordable housing, not phony affordable housing. And so all this started to dawn on me that there's something going on that just isn't right. And so, as I kind of got closer to being elected, I got more access to municipal lawyers. And the municipal lawyers were very much like, oh, yeah, but that you'll end up in court if you do that, and you know, all the reasons again why we can't. So it occurred to me that maybe I was asking things wrong. And I remember back when I was in corporate, my corporate years, one of the things that my boss told me was that I shouldn't go to the lawyers and ask them if I could do something. I should ask them how. Because if I say if, can I do this? Can I do this? I'm giving you the power. Because now you can decide if I can do it, right? But if I say how, I'm telling you I'm boss, and you're now gonna help me. And if you say I don't know how, I'll go to you and ask you how, right? Because I've decided what I want to do. So if a town decides what they want to do, and then they go and do it, it's different than if a town says, oh, you know, can we do this? And then they sit there frozen on a particular issue. And I have a long list of reasons or of actual things that we've done by using this approach. And so, how do I go from the next slide? So, should I just say next slide?
Sorry, next.
Next slide. Okay. So, the purpose of this is to share information for however you want to use it. It's to understand how to use the law to get what you want. So, yeah, we protest. Yeah, we educate. But at some point, we got to understand how the law works so we can make sure, A, it's not being used against us. So somebody's not telling us lies. And B, we use it to do the things that we want to do. Whatever it's going to be, you know, I'll tell more about that. So next slide, please. I am not a lawyer. By law, I must tell you this, because I have no license to practice law. I cannot give legal advice. Anything I tell you is just based on my experience, based on the things I've read, based on the things that I've experienced. And if you need any advice, you got to go to a lawyer. So I will help you work with your municipal lawyer, because largely what happens in my experience is that municipal lawyer A just wants to go home. They don't want to fight the U.S. government over the, you know, FERC, over the pipeline. They really just don't want to cause any trouble. They don't want to go to court. They don't want to go to trial. They don't want to be Perry Mason. They just want to go home. So you see a lot of rubber stamping of developer things. You see a lot of your committees. If you look at your conservation committee, I'm going to guarantee you that at least one person on that committee, probably the chair, works in the real estate industry. Why is that? He doesn't have any, but he can't actually vote on anything that has anything to do with his properties. But it's very convenient that he rubs elbows with his friends in the industry, and that they pass on how they want the laws to work in each town. So if you go to a conservation committee, you will find that every single request for an exemption from the Water Protection Act is approved. Why is that? When we have the power to say no, why are they approved? Oh wait, new tax revenues. So Town Hall is a corporation that wants the new tax revenues, so you get approved, so your water gets infiltrated with poisons, perhaps, and they're telling you there's nothing you can do when you can. But they're telling you that so they can get the new tax revenues to pay for their raises and everything else. I'm saying they don't need raises. What I'm saying is that you're being scammed. And so understanding how the law works and understanding how the money flows is your responsibility as citizens, because otherwise you're going to get used. By who? By the people whose job it is to use you. As a person working in the corporation, it is my job to take advantage of you. I wake up every day, I go into the meeting rooms with lawyers and other people who sit around trying to figure out how to rip you off. And I please, with all due respect, this is what I was trained to do, because I knew, as soon as I entered into the corporate and I discovered this stuff, I'm like, holy shit, we're screwed. But I'm going to sit here and learn as much as I can until I can't take any longer. It took me about 5 years, and I'm going to write books about this stuff, but for now, I went out and I learned how the law worked relative to the corporations, and now I'm going around telling everybody. So, because I find people don't read books. You know? They learn by this. They learn by people asking questions, because every community's got their own thing. So I go to Western Mass, you know, they call me to go lecture about pipelines. You know, all they want to know about is FERC, FERC, FERC. How do we sue the U.S. government? How do we do this and that? You go to, you know, some other community, oh, we just want to get rid of straws. You know, oh, you know, we want to stop NSTAR from spraying Agent Orange on our water supply, which what they do in every town in Massachusetts, by the way. NSTAR, the commuter rails, all of them have a license to dump tankers full of Roundup, which is Agent Orange, folks. Okay? You have to actually actively oppose this by filing with the state where your zone ones are around your water supply, and then they can't spray there. Do you know how many towns have done that? Like 10. Out of 300 and something. So people don't know this stuff. So I'm just going around telling them. Next, please. So I'm not a lawyer. Go talk to your own lawyer. But I can consult with you. Like in Groton, they want to do something. Your lawyer says, no, you can't do that. You can't impose FERC. And then 10 minutes on the phone with that guy, and we had an ordinance. Because I said, here, how about this language? How about that language? Oh, yeah. Well, that will work. Well, how can you tell us before? Oh, well, I want to go home. You know? And so, you know, when the Board of Selectmen tells the municipal lawyer, this is what they want, and then somebody like me gets on the phone with them and shows them how, happens really quickly with municipal lawyers. So, okay, so we're trained in society to believe that cities and towns must permit, that's why they use the word permit, because they're figuring out how much destruction will be permitted. It takes a lot for this to sink in. It's a permit to pollute. So, cities and towns must permit destruction of their valuable assets, heritage, safety, environmental, whatever it is, by corporation or the federal government, because of federal preemption in the Commerce Clause. So you're trained to think that the federal government rules. But in effect, unless Congress has made a specific act to the contrary, you have municipalities through, especially in our home rule state, have an incredible amount of power. As we're discovering now, you see all these fracking ordinances and different types of ordinances about the public trust, effectively. So this has worked very well to keep you in line, subservient to the federal government. You go to any town hall in the state and you say, you know, can you challenge the state? Can you challenge federal government? Oh, no, oh, no. Oh, they're very well trained. It's very well trained. So we're going to show you how we can break that mold, how easy it is, that all you've got to do is basically train, you know, share the information with your local officials. They're like, holy smokes, we're free. You know, suddenly when people get, when they experience freedom, when they experience what's going on in the rest of the country and they understand the case law, suddenly like, oh my God, you know, we're not held captive by these people. And it's very exciting. So local officials tend to be excited to hear this stuff. All right, so,
sorry.
Yes, question?
No,
anybody can ask any time you want to ask a question, please feel free. Okay, next one. You know, I know everybody's heard this, but big gas can come in and frack, drill for natural gas when the feds approve, right? Well, not necessarily. But for decades, we thought that we said no, the federal government would step in and force it down. And why is that? Because we have an inalienable right to self-governance when it comes to protecting our health and safety. Over and over and over again, we just continue to remind ourselves because we're trying to decolonize ourselves. We're trying to separate ourselves from the training that we got as children to that they are the parent and we are the child, will do what they say. That once we start to learn how much power we really have, we got to keep reminding ourselves because you go back into it and they start again, you got to say, no, 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 wait a second, everybody. So you constantly are reminding yourself because we got to ask all the time, under what authority? Under what authority? So when they tell you that we're sorry, but the train's coming through, you got to say, under what authority? So if you got to ask that question 100 times, you got to keep asking it because when you find out, well, golly, you know, they don't really have that authority. Oh my God, the water permit was not released again. You're pumping water, bottling it without a license. And so if the citizens don't constantly ask under what authority, then they will take that authority. All right, next one. So learning about the law is not just learning the history of law and the associated court cases. Learning law is about how it works. So law is fungible in the sense that you have a law that's on the books now, and it might read a specific way. But if somebody believes that their constitutional rights have been threatened, and they do something too that might be viewed as against that law, it then goes to court because somebody challenges it, and then they might be right. So that law, the whole law, might be unconstitutional. And how is that figured out? Only when someone challenges it. Only when somebody's willing to take the chance and go to court and expend the resources to challenge those laws. So Acton, for example, is challenging the Factor Daycare is one of these huge daycares with 300 kids. You know, with Bright Horizons or something like that, right? Anyway, so they're challenging the right, the quote-unquote right, of this daycare to have this huge factory right by an exit ramp. And so there's a thing called the Dover Amendment in Massachusetts, which says that religious organizations and daycares have the right to exist, so you can't stop them with zoning. And so now there's this discussion, was what was meant by that in our minds? Was a daycare like somebody that had it outside their home, who was an addition onto their home with 30 kids? Or was a daycare like a factory? So do you have a right to profit? Or was it a right to have a daycare? You see? So there's a very interesting challenge going on with that. Anyways, next one. So starting with how laws work, it's important to understand that the, I'm just going to change so I can face the camera this way. It's important to understand that U.S. law is largely based on... U.S. law is largely based on colonist law. So the United States was established as colonies. And the way colonies work is that the crown licenses basically a corporation to go and extract resources out of the land. Water, minerals, human resources. So in the Bay State Corporation, anybody that lives in the Bay State is considered a human resource. Surprising, isn't it? So, so you start to open your eyes and think, huh, wait a second. So the laws, many of them were, the Bill of Rights was in response to effectively corporate control of the governance. So the original constitution of the state of Massachusetts, for example, was denied. It was overwhelmingly disapproved by the citizens because it was too focused on property rights and corporate control. And the Bill of Rights was developed in the Essex Convention, which was a bunch of people that got together as towns and developed a Bill of Rights. They said, well, you put these Bill of Rights in there and then we'll approve it. Ah, okay, so we have to understand that these types of conflicts are always getting sorted out in law, that law is never fixed. Your rights are fixed because God gave them to you. What are those rights? We are always trying to figure out how the law supports those rights. So we sort that out by when people challenge, and then the courts decide. So, all right, there we go. Next slide, please. Yes, so the Constitution was set up to guarantee profit for the merchant class. Is that a surprise to anybody?
No.
Okay. And I don't need to go into that. And so it was derived from corporate charters, what I just said. And so the next one. Oh, yes, this is the back one. So then so the first goal was not to protect the communities, but to permit the extraction of the resources. Again, permitting. So when they say permit, people think, oh, that's very positive because they're permitting. No, they aren't. They're letting somebody take something. And so for us to change that is a holistic evolution to, for example, when you have a operating permit for a business. People think that that's by right, isn't it? But it isn't. The legislature gives corporate rights because it serves the social compact. So your locality, your town hall, gives out a building permit every year to McDonald's, to Staples, or whoever. So they could say, well, we've changed our mind, Mr. Corporation. We now believe that a living wage is important. We now believe that zero waste is important. We now believe whatever it is we think is important, and we're not going to give you your business permit any longer. Corporation says, no, I'm going to sue you. If the town's like, oh, all right, then I guess we give up, right? But if the town cares about these things and the town puts aside a bit of a budget, they can defend these things, and we're finding that it's cheaper and cheaper and cheaper because we're building a mass of information that we can share. So, for example, Concord, Mass, wanted to ban single-serving water bottles. Did I get that right, single-serving water bottles?
Yeah.
And so industry said, no, you can't do that because we have a right to profit. We got the federal preemption. You guys are the child, we're the parent, you know, and we control the government, so ha. And the attorney general said, no. The town of Concord has the right to protect itself from a threat to its health and safety. Industry said, oh, but that threat hasn't been proven. Because it's the science that they're relying on is, you know, kind of iffy. There's no proof that these bottles are problematic. Attorney General said, well, they don't have to have proof. All they have to do is suspect. All they have to do is decide that they want to ban them. Done. 40-page letter from the Attorney General. That exists. That means that practically anything can be done in Massachusetts now to protect the health and safety. Ha-ha. Okay? The fracking people, okay, they said, whoa, no, fracking. Industry said, wait, you can't regulate CAS and industry utilities. That's a federal job, federal preemption. You lose, parent, child, we're the boss. Went to court. They said, well, they aren't regulated. They're banning. language, law, fungible. If your intent is to protect the health and safety of your citizens, we are winning over and over and over again. So, next one. Ah, CELDEF. People know CELDEF? Community Environmental Legal Defense Fund. Fantastic program. They've got, I think it's 4 2-hour lectures about the same stuff I'm talking about. But I do a broader thing on social justice and all that stuff too, but they have a fantastic program that's specifically for environmental stuff. They won't work in Massachusetts, but you can watch the tapes for free. And Gail Darrell, who was our New England coordinator, died. And so, just a moment of silence for my dear, dear friend and mentor. They coined the phrase, the only thing that regulations regulate is activists. If you, in the box of allowable activism, where you got the laws over here, the laws over there, the laws over here, the laws over here, and you're allowed to speak at the mic. But only over here. Do you see? So the box of allowable activism is getting smaller and smaller if we don't act. And so they figured out if we worked on local law, we can break that box of allowable activism to be very, very large. Next slide. Oh. Right to self-governance, natural conflict between our rights to protect ourselves and federal preemption. But federal preemption only applies where states are being discriminatory towards a specific type of business. Discriminatory. So federal preemption was designed to keep Delaware from being snotty about its waterway. Because if Pennsylvania and other people wanted to ship their stuff out, and Delaware was being selfish with its waterway, it's being discriminatory to the rest of the nation. So type things like that. And they claimed that on Concord. And Concord said, well, no, we're not discriminatory because nobody can sell banned bottled water here. Not discriminatory. No federal preemption. Right? So the more we understand about how it works, the more we can understand how much we can do. Unless, of course, there's an overarching national interest for permitting, again, a specific project. Railroads. Everybody like railroads? Everybody here like railroads, right? Well, railroads were an overarching national interest, you know, and pipelines. We need gas. We need gas. It's an overarching national interest. But what we're finding now is that this concept of overarching national interest is a corruption of a process designed a long time ago that required, so it mandates for things like telephone lines, for electric grid, for pipelines. And that now that we have options, solar and wind, etc., that we're finding that we don't necessarily need all these pipelines. So it's not an overarching national interest, is it, if we don't actually need it? So the concept of a public necessity is changing as we start to gain power from the local on up. So South Carolina last April, I think, they won a very important case about electric grid. The FERC was claiming that they needed another high power tension line and that South Carolina needed it badly and all the states in the South Carolina region, so overarching national interest. They're gonna permit the electric companies to plow through their forests and put up these, you know, new whatever. And South Carolina said, no, you know, we'll decide if we need this stuff. We don't need you to tell us what we need. And they won. Because it's not an overarching national interest any longer. So if you go to the FERC process, if you write into the FERC process, and you say, yeah, I do this every once in a while, and I say, hey FERC, how you doing? Public call center line. I was just wondering how you determine what's in the public interest. And they're like, well, we presume that if a company wants to build a pipeline, that it's in the national interest. Just let that sink in for a second.
Right, right.
So if a company wants to build a pipeline, then it's in the national interest.
By definition.
By definition, by presumption. I actually put that in the next letter. So you're saying it's a presumption, it's a legal term. She wrote back, didn't know what I said. Oh, thank you very much. And I was like, forward that off to the activists. They're going to court, you know, to sue the government. And so the whole process is corrupt. The whole process is unconstitutional. Because the public necessity should actually be a public necessity, right? Not profit for a few.
I keep getting confused about that, when you say sort of all, the whole constitution was set up to support the corporation, and yet, to me, the understanding was the corporation was made as a person, but late in the 1800s.
The original colonists were corporations. The original Federalists wanted the Constitution to be about corporations, so they largely won, but we have the Bill of Rights, we have other things in there, and case law also supported by the states' constitutions are making it so that it's more people-centric, people-friendly.
Okay.
So you're having, the corporations are having less success these days than they did, you know, when we were kind of like blindsided by the fact that we needed a train, you know, trains across the country. And so this advantage is no longer as valid as it was before. I mean, 30, 30 years ago, you know, public thought was that we needed these gas pipelines, and so, you know, there was not that resistance. So now there's a resistance, and there are people are thinking, wait a second, you know, wouldn't the process of public necessity actually have some analysis?
Mm-hmm.
You know? Oh, wait, oh, there is analysis? Oh, it's done by this consultant that works for the gas company? Wait a second. So we're starting to unravel all this now. And we're starting to understand that if we want government for the people, if we're actually going to abide by the Declaration of Independence, we're actually going to abide by the Constitution of the states and all this kind of stuff, then we have to re-examine these things. And that's what we're doing. And so by passing local laws that sometimes get challenged, if you're in the state of Massachusetts at least, and you get challenged and Attorney General supports you, they put those costs and support. So the Attorney General, for example, if the bottle ban got challenged up to the Supreme Court, the Attorney General would then go do that. So that you try to be clever about your legal expenses, so you have very low at the local level, and then you pass it off basically to the state to defend you. All right, next one. So it's a natural conflict. The natural conflict of this federal preemption and corporate control of the government versus our rights, and so there's always this natural conflict. And so in the past there was very much more of this, and now there's more of this. And so it's a danger to our community, but it's also an opportunity. So we're finding that as we unravel and unpack all this stuff, that we have so much power that we're not using. And so so for me, I think it's really exciting, and that's why I'm here, because I'm like, you guys care. And so you know, if you know this stuff too, you know, maybe we can like all start doing stuff. And so, you know, in my own town in Acton, you know, I got elected, you know, you guys can look it up, but and so they're like, oh my god, all this stuff he says is coming through, you know. And so what I do is that, you know, they say, well, you know, oh, she just goes around finding burning embers and throws gas on them, you know, whatever, you know, it's just information, right? So I'll find this group of people who are like, oh god, we can't save the barn, we can't save the forest, and I start feeding them all this information. They're like, holy smokes. So they go back to the elected representatives and they're like, just does this and that, and then I was like, rrr. And so, you know, eventually when they win, they're like, oh my god, she's right again. You know, and so it's like, you can't hide from the truth. And so all I'm trying to do is spread the truth. So if you want to elect me, you can do what you want. But, you know, you're not going to stop me. You're not going to stop. You can kill me if you want, but you're still not going to hide from the truth. Right? And so, anyway, here we go. So we're making the rules. And so if we want to make the rules, you know, we have an inalienable, so the myth is that there's an inalienable corporate right to profit. So do you think there's a right to profit?
They're working hard on it.
Working hard on it.
Yes.
And a lot of people
think
that.
Most people believe that.
They believe
it's
that.
The law.
They believe it's
yeah.
the
law.
Yes. And so a very important case that happened, the casinos, it was last fall. So the casinos were coming in and they wanted to, they were upset because the state was letting something go to the ballot to let the voters decide whether or not they wanted casinos. The casinos were like, huh, that's not our business plan. Ballot questions aren't in our business plan. You know, we have a plan to make profit, and you are disturbing us by this democracy thing. You know, huh. And so they challenged up to the SJC, saying that they had this right to the profit, and the ballot initiative was getting in the way of their profits. Well, SJC ruled, we're really sorry, but you're in business. Businesses have risks, and we have a duty to protect the social compact. Bing. Finally, we have it now in paper. You do not have a right to profit. I'm really sorry, but no, you don't. So this is not worked its way entirely through land court, which is part of the reason why this daycare thing is so important to happen, is that this is a contract side, land use side, so they try and separate all these legal things, but we're starting to blend them too, because it's all about social compact. Like, you can call it contract law, you can call it something else, but it's all protecting the citizens, you know? And so the courts are starting to understand this. It's called the public trust.
you can separate the law in all these different ways you want to try and, you know, get us into a little box of allowable activism, but we're breaking down those barriers by challenging even those segregations. So, anyway, I forget where it was, but all right, let's keep going. So we do nothing, they win. They really literally have armies of lawyers which intimidate staff. They run the process around circles and bury administration paperwork. If you look at what a selectman has to read every week, literally, it's like this. It's a tiny little print, crazy amount of work, and it references this and references that, and it's industry people are doing all this stuff on the side. So it's really, really hard. They're tied up in knots in their favor. We are all tied up in knots. So we're trying to break that by handing everything to everybody. So it's like, oh, wow, you're fighting that? Bang, you know, here's this is an instruction booklet. We got an instruction booklet for some of this stuff. You know, which is step by step by step. Oh, you're fighting this? Okay, here's that. You know, so we have this sort of like network of, you know, people who are knowledgeable in the law and that trade the information, or, you know, or share the information. All right, next one. All right, these are great. This is great. I love this. So this is BITS. The Commerce Clause is about you can't stop progress. Right? Right? Y'all hear that, right? So everybody gets that fed from the beginning. Federal preemption, can't fight the feds. Dillon's rule, states tell towns what to do. You know, the parent-child relationship. Contract law, corporations rule, property rights, nature is property. We have the right to destroy. Presidential directives. These are great. Presidential directives. Did you know that there's a presidential directive from, I think it's the 1980s, that said that we have a national mandate to pump as much oil and fossil fuels out of the earth as possible, as fast as possible. It's a mandate. Why is it still on the books? When it's not even true. We don't have a national mandate. There's no public necessity. Who determines this public necessity? When is this reviewed? Why isn't Obama, who has one stroke of pain, can nullify that? This interesting stuff. Next slide. All right, so where do people get power from? So, you know, I get power from God. God's a, you know, some universal place. I'm bored, I got power. And so if we understand that we have God-given rights, inalienable rights, and those rights are different from legal rights. So God-given rights, legal rights. Legal rights are stuff that are on the books that have words, that courts respect, that people like, the law. You know, this is what God gave me, this is the law. And sometimes it doesn't always match because the law might be behind. Or, you know, because we are discovering stuff about ourselves, like, huh, do we have a right to water? Well, yeah, hell we do, you know? So, you know, is that respected by the law? Well, golly, it might be in the state constitution, it's not in the federal constitution. So, are the feds actually respecting that? Not really. So, we start to unravel that to make law match God-given inalienable rights. Let's see. So, towns and cities derive power from the U.S. Constitution, the Massachusetts Constitution, and the town charters. I'll get to some of this in a little while. Home rule. We have special rights in Massachusetts because we are home rule. And I'll tell you more about that. Basically, case law supports a liberal interpretation of the concept of local sovereignty. So home rule means that we get to decide. So if the states specifically pass a law which takes away our municipal power, then we don't have that power. But anything else, we're supposed to have the rights to do whatever we want. It's very, very limited cases on what states have done to take away home rule in Massachusetts. One of them is voting rights. So you have to have a consistent process for voting in every town. You can't decide. So sorry, no local sovereignty. Risky debt instruments. Can't engage in risky debt instruments, hedging and all that stuff. It's very much more limited, so no, you can't decide. But largely, yeah, you can. There are a lot of ways that we can. So individuals derive legal power from the Constitution, Bill of Rights, property rights, contracts, and organizing. Because even when the law says or doesn't say, if you get enough people, the law responds. Law follows culture. John Boniface was the first person to say that to me, I think, and I believe it, that when people stand up, that the law will follow. Okay, so, and again, legal power comes from national power, we already talked about that. We automatically have the right to exist. We don't need papers or documents or courts to grant us the right to exist or the right to natural resources. Next slide. Okay, utilities, however, They derive power around satisfying community needs. So we think, or at least we're told often, that FERC, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, rules, and because corporations own the government, then the utilities basically do what they want. And so you might as well just give up. Pipeline coming through? Oh well. Yeah, you can protest, but you might change the direction of it, you might change the size of the safety regulations or the noise or whatever it is, but yeah, you can't do anything about it. But in effect, the powers permitted by the federal and state government when a community interest has been determined are called national interest determination, eminent domain, rights of way, preemption. But how those rights are determined is largely based on this public interest determination. So if the process for determining the public interest determination is flawed, constitutionally flawed, do you think that the permit for eminent domain is valid? Right? But if nobody does anything, then they're just going to follow the process. You're going to be, you're going to follow a particular process and you're screwed. So the more you can learn about this, the more you can resist. Next slide. Jurisdiction, basis, legal basis. So jurisdiction basically just means, you know, the geography and the types of things that you have authority over. Basis is there a law that provides you the basis for challenging? So if you said that you didn't want poisons put on your water supply by insert, and the first thing the state's going to ask is, do you have an ordinance that says they can't? Do you have a legal basis to challenge them? Okay, so if you look at your local charters, you often won't see that you have a right to clean water. I don't think there's any town in the state that says you can't dump poisons on my water. You just assume that the government takes care of it. You assume that the state takes care of it. You assume the regulators take care of it because the regulators are owned by who?
The corporations.
Right, so why would you assume that they are going to protect you? So why don't you have an ordinance that says you shouldn't dump herbicides on your water supply?
Why would they be dumping?
To keep the weeds away?
Because it's permitted. But it melts the weeds. It melts the weeds.
It melts the weeds. Okay.
It evaporates. It's Agent Orange.
And that makes it easier for the water to...
Yeah, it's cheaper, more profit. I used to go around cutting them, mow them. Too expensive, dump chemicals. Okay. Monsanto, everybody's happy. The citizens don't even know. Mm-hmm. All right, authority and standing. So to have standing, you need to have, how do I explain standing simply? So it's like in the pipeline, people come to me and they're like, Tara, why don't you do something? It's like, I don't have standing. It's not going through my yard. So when you have standing, you actually have a legal right to something. You have more legal rights than somebody who's outside of the property where it's coming through. It's not directly affecting me. All right, next slide, please. I just want to read this. I just want you to read this straight through. I'll read all that. The states carve up cities and towns and award municipal charters. Many states, including Massachusetts, base their home municipal charters on home rule. So according to Mass state law, any city or town may, by adoption, amendment, or repeal of local ordinance or bylaws, exercise any power or function which a general court has power to confer upon it, which is not inconsistent with the constitutional laws enacted by the general court before me, blah, 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 blah. Which is not denied or expressly or by clear implication to the city or town by its charter. So anything a state can let you do, it has to let you do. All right, next slide. This was tried in, it's like 1970 or something like that. So state housing people wanted Hanover to do something. And Hanover was saying, screw you guys, we have the power to do whatever we want ourselves. And so this was tried, and Hanover won. It says, if the state can't allow the town to do it, it must. Everybody done with this?
I'm
good. Everybody done with this one? I'm looking at people reading it, so it looks like they're reading it.
I was chewing on it.
Yeah, you were chewing on it, okay. Any questions?
I don't really understand what that meant.
So what it means is that if someone tells you that you can't do something because the state isn't allowing you to, and the feds aren't allowing you to, so we have to wait for Washington to fix our problems.
Yeah.
And so if I told you, wait, you could do this locally, if the state can let you do it, they must. Once the state has specifically taken that power away from you, they have to let you. It's like Concord's wanting to ban water bottles. The state hasn't told them that they can't, and so they can.
Okay.
Right. So we're breaking the fallacy that we have to wait for
approval from the federal.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, that's the whole marijuana thing, or gay rights, or...
Hold on.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
Next?
I think so. Oh, this is just to, this is the kind of thing where, like, Massachusetts is doing it, but, you know, Massachusetts is weird, you know, they're gonna get challenged, so don't rely on this fact. No, it's happening all over the place. New York calls for a liberal interpretation of local power, extolling the importance of local land use powers, create an implicit presumption against preemption. An explicit presumption against preemption. And so Case Western Law Review is great. You know, they're widely respected, you know, lawyers, law. And they do analysis. There's another one that's coming up, and it was about looking at home rule in general and how powerful it is and how much we're not using. So, you know, this is not just Tara making this stuff up. I'm just reporting. Next one.
A question on that?
Yes.
Is that a New York legal decision interpretation, or is that a recommendation for...
That's the actual interpretation of case law.
Really?
A lot of people didn't know. All right, just, you know, like, I guess I like to give examples of, you know, wins where we have won the right to self-governance. Transit, there was a improvement, a dual track system going through for the MBTA commuter rail through South Acton. And it was going through through a heritage site. And the Jamie Aldridge told us, oh, you know, nothing you can do, we're really sorry. But after we unwrapped that, we found out that it was federal funds, and federal funds are tied to protections of heritage, tribal lands, you know, newts, special flowers, whatever it is. And so because of that, we could stop it. And so where the circumstance was a $1 billion project that we put on hold, and we redesigned the whole station based on the heritage people, you know, request. So when they told us that, no, we're really sorry, there's nothing you can do, we find out that, well, gosh, there is a lot we can do. Utilities, we're unwrapping the whole FERC thing. The factory farms, Pennsylvania has done a great work at unwrapping that. Hazardous materials, prohibitions, herbicides, single-use plastic bags, over and over again, we're seeing wins all over the place, upheld by the courts. So.
Next.
I think we've gone over all this stuff. We can make the regs. Town meeting votes are required, then you call your town meetings, citizens petition, however you want to do it. I have a lot of recommendations on how. I prefer to, I've gotten my head handed to me at town meetings when you have them against your friendly selectman. So I go to the selectman and say, I want to do this, and they're like, oh, we don't want to. And I'll say, oh, well, too bad, I'll have a special town meeting. So I just go get the 100 signatures. And I go to town meeting. If they said, oh, we don't want to do that because it'll take 100 hours to review and analyze it. And so I would go to a special town meeting and they'd spend 1,000 hours meeting me. So now what I do is I say, I tell you what, why don't you do the analysis and I won't hold a town meeting. So it's a whole different view of using the power. So not abusing the power, but rather using the power or leveraging it. Next slide. Wetlands protections. As long as you build in the buffer zone, you are permitted. Well, as long as you don't build in the buffer zone, you're permitted to build. But Massachusetts has enacted much tighter regulations than the federal. So if the federal preempted us, then why are we able to tighten up our wetlands? Supported all the way up, all the way up, all the way up. So these are just examples of how Massachusetts is able to have much higher protections for health, safety, et cetera, than federal. Okay, I think so. I think I've gone all of this, so we'll skip this one.
Skip?
Yeah. Just learn, enact ordinances. Yep, keep going.
lots of ways to do it. Cease and desist, I mean, it depends on what's your biggest problem here, Anita? I just wanted to want to get, because this was designed for some pipeline people that are pretty desperate. Tell me a problem, a problem.
Huh. I don't know. It's a person in our town wants to build a solar farm, but he has a lot of land. He's a farm. And we did pass a bylaw, and now we're afraid that this bylaw might be not overturned, but if this person is allowed to do certain things that, you know, what would you call it? If they go before the Zoning Board of Appeals, then they can allow this man to do certain things that are already on the, we made a bylaw against.
Why would he be allowed to do things that you have banned?
Well, when we're afraid that, we don't know what to do because he's going to the Zoning Board.
You don't know what his defense is or what his...
Well, he owns a farm, and that is part of the bylaw that we instituted in regard to the solar farms. Because they wanted to build a solar farm right in the neighborhood. You know, lot, solar farm, lot, you know, like that. And we challenged that. And
but
we
you banned that. That's a prohibited use?
Yes, yeah, yes.
Okay.
And so we made the bylaw that had all the prohibited uses. And one of the acceptable uses is, if you have a farm big enough, you know, I don't know what the acreage is, and you have a big enough peripheral, you know, around the solar farm, you know, then it's allowed. But he wants to cut down some forest land to do it, which is part of his land.
So why don't you do, there's a land clearing limitation in the bylaw, there's all kinds of ways to take care of this.
Land clearing limitation?
Yeah, but if you're saying that he is within his quote-unquote rights right now, then, you know, you can't stop them. Or you could if you decided to, but you would have to get 10,000 people, you'd have to do all kinds of things. And, yeah, you know, I mean, I'd have to look at the specifics, but
yeah.
The point is that you're doing the right thing. You're looking at your laws, you're looking at what this guy wants to do,
right.
And figuring out, you know, how to prohibit what you don't want him to do.
Right. Well, I mean, he's would be allowed to do it, but in doing it, he'll be destroying this forest. Land that is on his land.
Well, I mean, you guys set it up. You passed a law that allowed him to do it.
Yeah.
So you need to act if you want to save that forest.
Yeah.
And you've got to get some language set up that, you know, is allowable by law.
Yeah.
You know, right now there's a land clearing bylaw that has not been actually implemented yet. But it makes it illegal to, I think it might be 2/3. It makes it illegal to clear more than a certain amount of any land. I don't know if it's by lot or if it's by what. But that would have to be enacted.
Mm-hmm.
You can do that, 45 days, town meeting, then you're banned. And that's in your town bylaw, not in the zoning bylaw. That's always, everything's so tricky. And why is it tricky?
It's tricky
because they want to confuse you. It's helpful if you're confused. It's helpful that if you have legal fees. It's helpful if tie you up in knots. The corporations, they have people that are professionals that run around doing all these people all the time. We're blowing up with the petitioning exercise, right? So, you know, each place is different. They have different hours. They have different this and that. Well, for the pros, that's great because grassroots groups cannot compete. But you have the opportunity, at least, that you know your laws. You know some stuff. I can give you some stuff.
What can I add? What is the obligation? Like the town, each town has a town council. So if she, not being as familiar with the bylaws, to your point, you know, sort of went and asked, how? Like, what is the legal counsel's obligation to answer a citizen's questions regarding the bylaws?
No, he's not at all because remember the town is a corporation.
Right. Okay. So
he's
representing the town's interests.
You elect people to go into the corporation and serve.
Right.
And so you have to get your selectmen to tell the town manager who pays the municipal lawyer to make time to speak with you, and then you get a couple people to go to that meeting. Is that helpful?
A little helpful. I'm just still hung up on the ZBA.
Well, the ZBA.
Because if he goes in front of the ZBA, they might give up, for an allowance, I don't know what the word is, but
yeah.
For an appeasement or something like that.
Yes.
I don't know the word. If they allow it, then that kind of cuts away at the bylaw that we instituted to two or three years ago.
Right, but you have to defend that. You have got to prepare materials, you got to go to the ZBA, you got to write letters. It helps if you have a selectman. So for our daycare, we got a bunch of people to go to selectmen. The selectmen are like, oh gosh, seeing there's a whole bunch of people here, I guess we'll vote for it. So they voted to stop the daycare, and they put the funds aside for the lawyer to prepare a case, and you know, they did that. If the selectmen weren't for it, we would have a factory daycare there, but I'm not sure. So learning how that process works is really valuable. And by the way, generally speaking, the municipal lawyers have office hours where they come to the town for like 2 hours a week. And so you ask, I always ask for 10 minutes. Uh-huh. And so you get really prepared. You give stuff in advance, and then you get there and they've read it already, blah, 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 blah. So you do all that homework to minimize the $400 an hour. That's what it is. Yeah, yeah, it's crazy, man. But we can do it. I mean, I have evidence that we're doing it. So we can share this information with you. Another one, minimum wage, living wage. Seattle, Chicago, I think now, there's all these places passing minimum wage laws on a local level. So the operating permit for the business will not be granted unless they pay a living wage. So there's very exciting things that we could be doing on the local level. You know, Deerfield is suing the federal government based on the stuff that I was saying, unconstitutional process, cease and desist from the FERC. Now how that's all played out right now, but. Rights of nature, this has not been tested in Massachusetts, but New Hampshire and Pennsylvania and Maine. To pass the rights of nature, it's very hard to get these exemptions and all of these, allowable destruction.
Can you give an example of that?
Oh, the fracking, the factory farms, you know, the right for nature to exist,
okay. To
stay in a forest or something. Farms have wetland protections. Oh, in fact, an ordinance out in Western Mass that may be challenged. They have determined that organic farms have the right to not be polluted by something, which I can't remember what it was. It was related to pipeline. It was pipeline chemicals that it can't get anywhere close to the thing. Yeah, it was zone one, zone two. I think somebody passed that too. So these are local regs that haven't been tested yet, but the prohibition, the fracking, the bottle ban, strengthening the conservation restriction. So right now the pipeline people want to overturn the conservation land restrictions that say no disturbance of the meadow or the farmland or the forest. They want to retract that so that the state can give them a permit to put a pipeline through. So right now it takes 2/3 to get the conservation restriction pulled. And so the towns can act to put the state on notice that their conservation restrictions can't be overturned unless they want to face a suit by the town. So these are towns that are taking a stand. High fees for destruction of gecko habitat all over the country that's happening. Land clearing limitations, that's the one I was referring to. Next slide, please. Legal harm. So you have to, a lot of people are like, oh man, the environment. We gotta save the environment. What's that mean? You know, how many parts per million? You know, you have to establish legal harm because this is a capitalist design system which permits people to do stuff to the environment based on colonist law to extract resources, the right to profit. So if you are not going to ban it and you want to sue them, you have to establish what the harm is. So the bottle ban people, they didn't have to because they banned it. They just said, no, screw you guys. We don't like it. We don't have to prove why we don't like it. We just don't like it. And so instead, this part about harm, if you wait until after it happens, you have to determine how much the harm is, what is this, all that kind of stuff. So it's really hard to recover community resources. It's much easier to ban corporate activity. Right now, for example, in Western Mass, just the announcement that the pipeline's going through and the property values plummeted. It's a legal harm. Yeah. So I would be fine. I would be standing here, man. I'd be preparing court documents. But it's not mine, so I don't have any basis. authority, I have no jurisdiction, you know what I'm saying? So I get to go around telling everybody about your basis and jurisdiction. So the process for claiming harm, and you guys don't need to know this right now, but polite warning, you wait for some period of time, you say, the state of Massachusetts, you know, your inaction is causing me harm. I'm about to do this, actually. I don't know how long I'm going to do this, but I discovered that there's soot from exhaust on my bed cover coming to my window because there's a highway out there. The state has failed to protect me. Okay? So I send them a letter. Some days later, I send them a letter and say, I'm sorry I didn't hear from back from you. Of course, love this stuff. Because I say, you give them a polite, you know, they say, I didn't hear back from you, and therefore I consider you complicit in the crime against you. Let's consider this your first warning. You give them two or three more warnings, right? And then you have a claim of harm. So once you give them the polite warnings, then you have a claim of harm. So there's a process. Next one. Yeah, I just explained that. Okay, keep going.
Onward?
Yep. Fraud. Oh, God. This is for the pipeline people. These, all these lies are out there, so they're proceeding with that stuff, too. You can go on. So, in summary, if you do nothing, destruction will happen. It's required by law. You know why? If you're a part of a public corporation, you're a fiduciary duty to make profit, which means a fiduciary duty to pollute, to rip you off, etc. It's not called ripping off. Sorry. I need to say, to serve you better. And make profit from my shareholders. There's nothing wrong in that, is there? Because growth will happen and people need jobs anyways, right? So you will sign this permit. So you have a lot of power to push back and say no. It's relatively easy if you actually do it. And if you actually want to, if your community wants to. And the first step is your selectmen. If your selectmen want to do it, you can do practically anything. All right, next slide is, and organize, educate, and legislate, and that's why we're here. Thank you, Occupy Natick.
Yeah, thank you.
Oh, I won't.
So the selectman is your way in because he's the one that's elected to be in the corporation.
That's right.
Okay.
Because he's in the corporation, which is part of the state, which is part
and
of the state.
He has the right to go into that lawyer and ask
darn
the
right. Darn right. Okay. Now, make the next one. I just want you guys to, this next slide is a preamble to the Constitution, which basically says all a bunch of nice stuff, but the next one is the beautiful part. The people of this Commonwealth have a sole and exclusive right to governing themselves. No man, nor corporation, or association of men have any other title to obtain advantages or particular or exclusive privileges distinct from those of the community.
That's in,
wow.
This is in our current,
it's in your state constitution.
Right. Okay. Has anyone ever read the state constitution?
Have you?
No.
That's good reading.
I thought you were going over on us. Yes.
No, I know. I think we know what our next book is.
Yeah, really.
Read the Constitution. That's great. That's very powerful.
Thank you.
No, you're welcome. Thank you for letting me talk because I need to tell people this stuff because that's why I'm taping. I hopefully the camera kept rolling. Yes.
Well, that's
true. She hasn't asked you one question yet. So, ma'am.
I have a question about standing. In my mind,
yes.
I'm thinking I have a right not to be contaminated with air, soil, or water. So that's kind of indirect harm, but if somebody wants to put a power plant through my town, which would encourage fossil fuel infrastructure building, it would open up the possibility of contamination or explosions or down the road, it's just more fossil fuels destroying the environment. So. Don't I have standing? Doesn't everybody
yes,
have standing?
Yes, certainly. It depends on who you're going to sue. So in the particular case where they wanted me to sue first, their process was about approving a pipeline that was, it was indirect. I could have sued as a tariff, a ratepayer, because they wanted the money for the pipeline to come from the ratepayers. Right? But then they were announcing, well, we're going to change that plan, and, in that case, I would have gotten all the way to court and found they didn't, we're not going to. But the most powerful is the person whose actual land is being polluted. But if, yes, we could engage in an air pollution campaign, there's New York State is suing, or I don't know what happened with it, but I read a case where they filed suit against the state of Illinois, saying, or Detroit, Michigan, maybe it was
Anyway, they sued one state against another state, saying that your pollution has caused health and safety harm on our citizens, and we want $6 billion.
Is that boring smoke we're talking about?
Yep, and if you don't stop, then we're going to continue, we want more and more and more. So it's happening, and so if you all want to do it, I would want to go and sue that the U.S. government's illegal. I mean, really. I mean, again, the Crown, you know, gave away the Indians' land. Hello? Right? I mean, how can that be the basis for a legal government? So, you know, there's lots of things we can do. It's how many people do you have? You know, because you gotta get the lawyer to help you, and the lawyers like to be famous, and so, you know, the lawyers that like to do this stuff, well, most of them want to just rubber stamp and go home. But the ones that want to get involved, if you tell them you got 1,000 people, you know, then they want to get involved. If you got like 3 people and you have an idea, you know. Well, that's how it's viewed, unless you've got 1,000 people. So you go around talking to people and getting signed up. You know, PassNet, what was PassNet? Like, you know, it was me and Nick, you know, at a strategic assembly, strategic action assembly in Compton Square with the hackathon, right?
Right.
You know, that's how I met Nick. I thought he was fun. I was like, what, you know what I'm talking about? He's like, yeah, I know what you're talking about. I think it's awesome what you're talking about. I was like, no, nobody here thinks it's awesome. Everybody thinks I'm crazy. The fact that you think I'm not crazy makes me, I suspect you. So, it took like 3 months before I trust him. I said, I want you to line up a meeting with the Attorney General of the state of Massachusetts, and I want to sit there and watch that person nod while you talk. So he goes to the guy at the Attorney General, and the Attorney General guy said, what? You guys are going to what? And he goes, that's big. And I'm like, yep, but, you know, that's what we're going to do. And he's like, well, I want you to develop the brief, the legal brief, that shows me that you understand the law enough to defend this. Hmm. So we're like, all right, so if that needs to be done, that needs to be done, what do we do? He goes, well, here's the 1,700 page document. And Nick went and read it, and put together the thing, and we edited the thing, and we got the meeting with the guy, and he sat there, and the guy nodded while Nick was talking. And I was like, all right, I'm in. So it takes a while, but once you start to gain power, you know, when we sit there and we understand what we're doing, we're in the state house and we're in a hearing with the Judiciary Committee, and people are like, yeah, you know, I mean, it happened, at least happened, and we're like, yeah, right? Mm-hmm. You're like, okay, you know, that wasn't that hard. You know, it's 3 years of work to get there, but, you know, what else can we do? And it takes people like you guys that if you have cause at your level, at the city town level, you can engage in, you know, an act, and we're engaged in this right to profit thing. And so you just decide what your thing is. Yes, Mike.
Another excellent example of just what you're talking about.
Yeah.
There's 2 counties in Hawaii that have passed a law saying that chemtrails cannot be distributed over their counties.
Wow.
And therefore they have wonderful drinking water, wonderful agriculture, and hardly anybody gets sick.
And in the state of Massachusetts, our legislators say, you're crazy, chemtrails don't exist.
Yeah.
Water.
No, that's sad.
Dumping poisons to try and manipulate the atmosphere, they're experimenting us, virus. They're going to be getting vaccines in the air.
One other thing, Tara, please. How can I get what you just put up there?
It's an older version is online. I'll upload a new version soon. But you can use the older one. It's on the thing. On the Occupy Natick site, there's the link to, if you scroll down, there's a link to my slides that I used to use like 6 months ago, but as I went to update them, I realized I didn't need that much updating. I basically fixed a couple typos.
Excellent. Thank you.
You bet. And then I don't know if this is still recording or not, but yeah, it is. So maybe I have this recorded finally. And, you know, even if I'm not on it, I'll put the slides on it.
Yeah.
And Bill was in that. It'll take like a couple weeks when he's doing past maps. Highlights from the state house.
That's exciting. So, I can't remember if you spoke at the beginning about what's going on with past mass and ways people can help. You did. You passed around them.
Yeah. Does anybody want to hear about past mass?
Yeah. I mean, especially since. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. In relation to this. Okay. So.
Yeah.
So past mass amendment is what. So corporations are not people. And I don't believe they have a right to spend as much as they want on campaigns. And I've been watching the stuff that's been going on. And I believe that it's time to use the state constitution to tackle these issues. And so we've engaged in a petition effort to amend the state constitution, saying corporations are not people, money is not speech.
We hope you'll help get signatures this fall. A lot of people in this room have already done that. We'll do that until we get it, but the legislature might actually do it for us. But what happens, what does the legislature do if we don't petition?
Nothing.
Nothing. Okay, so we're going to petition it until it happens. So please join us. And
so it's more around Citizens United and around funding of that, as opposed to, I mean...
Citizens United?
Yeah.
Did something happen to the federal government?
Yeah.
We can't overturn anything
from
here. What we can do is use our state constitution to protect ourselves.
Right.
From perspective, right? So it's, again, looking at the law from the perspective of protecting yourself as opposed to, you know, listening to how other people want you to view the law.
So can you were talking about how the legislature has adopted the language. So
yes.
What's going to happen with that, and how is that different from the constitutional amendment that's
It's the same thing, except for that the legislature requires 50% of the legislature to vote for the amendment. Whereas if we get the signatures, it only requires 25%.
Oh.
So we want to get the signatures. It also helps educate everybody. It's a really important thing to get a network of people that are prepared to stand up and get 100 signatures each every year, or 300 or 1,000, hopefully. And so every year we hope to, if this passes the next couple of years, we'll hope to make the next step to say, well, why don't we just say indigenous human beings only? That's the only donations you can accept.
Mm-hmm.
All of a sudden, your legislator works for you. Imagine that, Charlie.
Right.
Or Ed, or whatever, you know? And so these are the types of things that we're looking for. And we hope you'll join us. There's a sign-up sheet going around. Oh, no, you're already on. Yes, sir.
So on the federal Citizens United versus the state level thing that we're trying to accomplish, does that mean that the Koch brothers would not be able to put money into Massachusetts for issues, or
we don't know
this right?
We don't know exactly how it's going to work, because if we feel that it's important to establish the basis before we figure out the specific laws.
Mm-hmm.
So the basis is to use our Constitution to protect us, and then we figure out the laws. Amending the Constitution doesn't get challenged. The laws get challenged. So if we pass a law that says only human inhabitants can donate, then somebody else can challenge that. Was it the SJC? The SJC, because we have the basis, rules on Massachusetts law. If we didn't have that basis, they would look to other laws to be persuasive.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So that's why we're doing this first. It also will allow the GMO people and other people who want to put ballot initiatives together, they can get certified. We have that in place, they can get certified right away. Somebody else had a question back there that I didn't get to.
Well, I did wonder why it has to prove what a chemtrail is. Were you talking to me?
Well, I wouldn't think they would have to, for the same reason that Concord didn't have to prove that the bottles were a danger.
Right, they had banning it suspicion. Out.
Right. And so, remember, Citizens United was tried.
It was not as difficult as they thought.
Yeah, exactly. Because if you, again, you look at your Constitution, protect yourself. You're not overturning anything. You're not doing any regulating that the feds are reserved for the feds, whatever. You learn how to work within this stuff to protect yourself. And it's easy. It's just that we thought we couldn't do it before. And now we're realizing that we can.
Can we clone you?
Well, just set me up, put me on agendas, and I'll come, and I'll give the same speech everywhere. Anywhere you get 10 people, I'll come. 5 people, I'll come.
I have an observation, too, because I have a daughter who's a junior in high school now, and one of the things that, as she gets a little older and sort of pulls her head out of the clouds, she has said that she's taking a government class next year because she feels very ignorant. There's no civics anymore, so she has no understanding of how government works at any level, and was just felt really anxious about it. And I think it's really fascinating that we have such an incredible history around governance in this country, yet we don't make it, like gym is mandatory. They have to take 4 years of gym in high school, but they do not have to take anything that has anything to do with what your government structure is and what's going to happen when you turn 18 and you can vote.
Well, that serves the system
it
well because
the
all
system,
they want is workers.
Exactly.
They only want human resources because the system is set up to extract human resources for value.
So it's just, but I would say that the majority of people would feel that it would be really helpful to sit down and understand like this, like you go to your selectman and then you can draft a warrant and it has to go through a process at the
level, and if there's any financing involved in it, then it has to go before different committees, but then it gets on the warrant at town meeting, and I, as a town meeting member, can, you can approach a town meeting member and say, hey, I want your support for this, and the town gets to vote.
Maybe we should make up a little, isn't there a program or app online that you can make animation like that?
No, probably.
Yeah.
I'm taking a coding class in a couple of weeks.
A what?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that'd be great. Because I just, I mean, I'm the kind of person that stays up until 4 o'clock in the morning looking at case law.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I can't help it. Because, well, if somebody else would, like when I met Nick, and Nick is now obsessed about the past match, right? So anything that has to do with like that, I just shovel his way, he goes and does it, right? Yeah, yeah, but it's like, you know, if it's like environmental something or whatever, he's just like, you know, I mean, it's just, you know, it's a pipeline or FERC, you know, he'll look at it and give me his opinion, but I'm the one that has to read it all and put summary in front of him and get his opinion. But we also have like five other lawyers working on the FERC stuff, so, you know, I kind of just, you know, when somebody says, is there a right to something? And it makes sense to me that there should be a legal right to protect that. I'm like, ooh, and then I go and I look, like there's this Indian tribe that there's the other, they're living on their ancestral lands. Thousands of years they've been living there. Grandpa died, and because they're women, they didn't get the right to the ancestral lands. Because it's tribe law, not federal law. So in that particular instance, they're less protected by tribal law than they are protected by federal law. So I'm actually looking for laws where the feds can step in certain circumstances to protect the health and safety of people, the residents. Okay, are they citizens or are they not citizens? Who gives a shit? Are they immigrants or not immigrants? What label do they have on them? Right, and so I'm finding those case laws, it's really interesting. You know, because normally I'd be like, no, leave the tribes alone. They can do what they want. But now what we're doing is there's a bigger tribe that's subsuming this little tiny, they're only 30 people, and they're taking the grazing lands, and they're confiscating their sheep, using the Land Bureau of Management. They're using the federal government. They give, so the bigger tribe is giving them permission to go genocide them. So that's why I stay up like obsessed about looking at the case law on that, discovering anything that we can use to protect people. So thank you. I don't want to keep talking. I could just go on for hours about this stuff.
It's fascinating.
Yeah, it's great. Thank you so much.
Welcome. Any other questions?
Can I make an announcement?
Yeah.
Metro West Peace Action will have a table at Earth Day. I suppose Occupy will too.
Yes, we will.
Yes. And Metro West is going to be advertising nuclear abolition. We'll have the nuclear globe and show parts of the world don't have nuclear weapons. And we'll have petitions for you to sign. We'll be passing out water boxes, recyclable water bottle boxes. I think some students introduced to training. I do hope to stop by the table and sign our petitions, and just remember that they're planning on spending $1 trillion over the next 30 years on nuclear weapon modernization.
Ooh.
And if you think that is a waste, if you think that's a waste of money, come sign our petitions.
You have one more question for this?
Well, what about railroads and what they can carry through towns?
Yeah, that's a very interesting thing that's going on right now. There has been a move to ban fracked gas to go through pipelines. But again, that's touching on regulation. So is it a ban? Is it a regulation? We don't know yet. But I would be willing to pass that ordinance. I think we can pass as many ordinances as we possibly can.
And what about with railroads? I mean, like, I live across the street from a railroad that I thought was going to be a commuter rail. And it turns out that there are freight trains going through there night and day. Coming through here too.
I don't know. I mean, and I would take the chance and I would do it. But see, I got unelected because I'm willing to do stuff like that. You know, I would do it. But you know, you got to talk to your own municipal lawyer, your own selectman, and see whether they're willing to take that chance. I know I'm willing to lay my life on the line to protect the people I know.
Yeah.
And other people just aren't.
But
all commerce and inconvenience and all that stuff are more important. I'm sorry.
I'm thinking, because I'm not getting any responses. Like, I'm calling the town to see if they
How about, there could be nuclear waste going through there. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yes.
I have a flip side of that question. A problem in Natick, where the railroad isn't sending enough through town.
Mm.
And It's a project called the Cochituate Rail Trail. In 1830s, a railroad came through and got all kinds of special privileges to take land and put a railroad through, because everybody needed it in the 1830s. Well, a branch of that railroad goes past Lake Cochituate up into North Framingham. And Framingham owns its portion, 1.5 miles, and it's now a beautiful trail. You can go out and enjoy it. 2.5 miles of it in Natick is held by the latest railroad to buy it from a different railroad. And they bought it, I think, around 1990 from Conrail, which was a national effort to buy up rails and run them better when they were starting to fail, so they were getting dilapidated. Well, Conrail unloaded cheap, and somebody bought it up, and then they decided they wanted to unload this section. So there's no trains on it. It's abandoned in the official railroad sense. But they're asking 15 times what it's worth.
Do a blight ordinance.
That's what I'm fishing for.
Yeah, there's a blight.
They can afford to sit and wait. And the town can compromise and only 5 times what it's worth, you know, if they wait long enough. So that's their game.
Is there any, there's usually on those properties, there's usually hazardous waste.
There's usually what?
Hazardous waste. You can demand tests on the soil. Mm-hmm. You can do all kinds of stuff.
There is hazardous waste.
For what?
There is. It's a rare railroad that doesn't have.
So what?
You force them to clean it up, and they won't sell it to you for a reasonable amount.
Well, not only that, but when, that's right. So once it's blighted, or once it's declared as a Superfund site, for example, you get different rights. But you can engage in blight, eminent domain to blight. So you can, again,
well, of course
very polite letter. You
they
want
can
them.
Just say people shouldn't go on it, and it won't be a danger.
And then they'll fence it off. That's what they've done.
No. Blight is a site of blight.
Visual?
It's a visual site. So you have left that lot empty for too long. We consider that blight. We've passed a blight ordinance, and we're going to send you a nice letter that says, do something with your blighted land according to our master plan and our zoning, and if you don't, within a certain period of time, then we'll send you another letter that says you haven't answered, and blah, 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 and you proceed down in eminent domain.
How do you keep them from selling it off to the abutters?
You can buy it yourself. But eminent domain is well, they could sell it to the abutters, for sure.
Well, eminent domain seemed to me to be the right tool, but our selectmen, of course, were afraid to get dragged into a legal battle.
Well, of course they are, because they don't know.
And because it's a good bailout argument.
It's a good bailout, you know, they want to go home. They like to wait for the parade. So, but if you prepare the, if you show them a blight ordinance, if you show them some of the cases and stuff associated with eminent domain, you know, maybe they'll be willing to take the first step, which is just the 10-minute conversation with the lawyer during office hours. So that's all you really need. So all you do is get them enough information so that they're like, yeah, okay, I'll grant you 10 minutes with the guy, because he's coming anyway, and we already have to pay him. But you got to have your homework done. You can't just go there like, you know. I hear this chemtrails, you know. Like, you got to go in with the proper documentation. So that they know that you're not a cook, you know, because when you show them that you can do that research, and you show them that you have your act together and that makes logical sense, that the case, the brief makes sense, that they're not going to look like a jerk when they go up in front of a judge, then they'll work with you. And I'm here as living proof. I mean that. Not that I'm good. I mean, well, no, because at the first day, they're like, oh man, what is she talking about? That's crazy talk. And then over time, they're like, you know, wow, that starts to make sense. Because it's complicated. And it's complicated for a reason. Because as a corporation, it's much easier when the system is complicated for you guys to take control. More I can weave threads and knots that you guys have to wade through, easier it is for me as a corporation. Thank you. Anybody else? Any other questions?
I have a question. I don't know if I should just ask you, but
sure.
Okay. Can you tell us more about that case with the 10 towns that banned NSTAR from spraying Roundup or glyphosate, because I'm working on the March Against Monsanto, and that's what I'd like to get somebody to speak about that.
So the expert on that is Laura Kelly from Wellsby. And the 10 towns, if they didn't ban it, what they did is they sent in the documentation to, so the state allows towns to submit maps of their zone 1 and zone 2. Zone 1 is the closest to their wells and the marshlands. Zone 2 is not as close, but still valuable. And zone 3 is like, well, we'll let a golf course on, or you know, zone 4 is like, don't let the highway, don't let anything go. So zone 1 and 2, you can submit a map and they won't supposedly spray on those lands. If you catch them, it's a major violation, $300 per hour or something like that. But the point is that not very many towns have submitted those zone 1, zone 2 protection maps. Like, why not?
So you don't even have to pass the ordinance in the town?
You just get them to submit the map.
All right.
Crazy. But Laura Kelly, who I'll give you the contact information for, down the Cape, she's trying to get a full-out ban. She thinks that there shouldn't be any herbicides in the entire state. And she wants her town to ban it. So she's hasn't had any luck getting the ordinance, but for whatever reason, but she's working through the state to try and get the state to ban, which is really hard since Verizon and Instar are pretty well embedded in state politics. But she's doing it, you know, and the more people that can help, she would love to speak.
Okay.
No Instar now. It's Eversource.
Ever. Oh my
and
God.
They are from, I got my, looked my bill today, they're in Texas.
They're in Texas.
Yes.
Their spraying use again is just to get rid of weeds.
Yeah.
Okay, so they don't want to mow around their facilities. So I keep wondering, why would anybody want to put toxin? It's for weeding. It's for cheap weeds.
Do your neighbors put it on their sidewalks? They spray dandelions?
Oh, yeah, they put it on their yards.
It's going into your aquifers.
Yeah.
Or into your air. Mm-hmm. Or both. Anyway.
On all the food you eat.
Well, I mean, unless you're using organic,
And I was just sort of curious, because we have a blighted situation with Knobscot. We have now town leads where they're doing a lot more planning and they're bringing the town together. And it's been 15 years since this dead shopping center. We found it, you know, Shaw's owns it. So, you know.
My kids live there.
Yeah. And I thought about that. Well, we should just do a protest, you know, put, you know, obviously ban Shaw's or whatever, you know, try to, you know.
Well, you could ban the size. It's easy to write a zoning ordinance to restrict the size of the building.
Mm.
So you restrict the size of the building. So that has to be done in zoning.
That's what they're talking about. They're talking about rezoning.
By grandfathering. So you have to grandfather, which means that as soon as you start going to town meeting to restrict the size of the building, I'm going to submit a plan for the old zoning. And I'm grandfathered.
Well, for us, it's the problem is that nobody wants to build in there because
want them to build in there.
Yeah, we need something. I mean, this one is just a dead lot.
Oh.
Yeah,
and light.
Right, exactly. That's what I'm thinking. So
lots of light ordinance.
Yeah.
It forces them. It forces them to sell it to somebody that will use it.
Yeah.
That's what light ordinance was meant to do.
Yeah. That's the thing. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank
you. And anybody, you know, feel free to pass. Is on here. It's my email address. Mm-hmm. Petitioner's command is best, and so, and I will send you resources and help you.
And don't forget tomorrow night, Black Pearl.
Right. Did you have a question?
No.
All right, thank you.
All right,
thank you so much.
Thank you.